Yeah,
it's kind of away.
Well, it's funny you mentioned that because I remember in journalism school they had talked about the Nixon Kennedy debates in 1960 presidential election and how on TV Kennedy won, but on the radio the people said Nixon won because they didn't see him.
Yeah, that's an interesting concept, and that's very much the sentiment behind the whole song, is that it's about the way that your technology does affect people's perception of things.
Well, it's got to be interesting because that video was so, I mean, beyond the fact of being the first one played, it was the dawn of a new era. But then at the same time, it's so weird to think how much MTV has changed, you know?
Well, I mean, it's very interesting because, you know, it was a station that started off with the name Music as the first part of its title. And actually get to a point now where there is no music on it, but it's still called MTV. it's kind of weird, isn't it? You know, it's. But I think that sort of same thing happened with music as well. When you know people listen to albums, but not. You know, they have this idea of what these musicians were like. But you know when. This guy suddenly had to appear in 3 or 4 minute promotional videos. It was kind of awkward, really, because they'd never had to act before, and these videos started to take on really almost film-like proportions. You know, there were extravagant productions and. Even when you go to sort of a Michael Jackson level of. The thriller video costing over $1 billion to put together, you know.
Well, that's the thing, is like when you look at Owner of a Lonely Heart video, it almost seems like everyone feels like a fish out of water on the camera.
Yeah, and then in Owner of a Lonely Heart. Which one you were talking about? Sorry.
Yeah, that video, really? Owner of a Lonely Heart. Like when you watch it, I don't know if you've ever seen that video, but it just seems like everyone. Doesn't really know what to do with their hands or their body because they're being filmed.
Well, that's it, you know, and I think we had the same thing with Asia on A Couple of Hours, is that, you know, everybody looks a bit awkward because, you know, it's not really your domain, you know, you didn't start off as an actor, you started off as a musician.
Yeah. What sets the
I mean, some guys were cool.
Oh yeah.
Some guys look cool, you know, like Sting.
Sting always looks cool, you know.
Yeah.
I'll never be as cool as Sting.
Yeah, it's annoying, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. what is it that sets the keyboards apart from other instruments for you? Why the keyboards?
Well, both my parents played keyboards, so my dad was a church organist, and my mum used to play the piano. So I sort of grew up in a house where the keyboard was very much to the fore, and so I started with piano lessons when I was about 6 or 7, and I carried on ever since, really. And it was always very much, if I was ever going to be, I never really got on with the guitar or anything like that. So I was always going to be. I think in the keyboard world somehow.
Well, other keyboardists I've interviewed over the years say that, in their opinion, although it might be biased, but I tend to agree with them, they say that it's the most versatile instrument on stage.
It is, and I think that certainly exponents like Keith Emerson showed what could be done in terms of bringing the keyboards to the fore in a band, and I remember seeing him when I was sort of in my late teens. I went to the Isle of Wight Festival, and the Nice were performing there, and that was really a kind of a turning point in my vision of what I should be doing, because I think prior to that, pretty much the keyboard player was just a guy who sort of sat in the back of the stage and fiddled around with a piano or a Hammond organ or something like that. But all of a sudden to see Keith Emerson, you know, riding this thing and taking lead lines and you know, really being at the forefront of the band, it really clicked with me. And I thought, well, this is what this guy's doing, and anything's possible.
Yeah.
And I think the way that the keyboards have developed, becoming much more orchestral in their nature, gave me, it was really the area that I wanted to move into anyway. And so it was, you know, I was sort of perfectly poised to be able to put my dreams into reality, you know, which was to be a very kind of orchestral player, create arrangements on keyboards. And really the Buggles was the start of all that for me, when it was just two of us, and we thought, well, what can we do with these keyboards and make it sound orchestral, you know? And I think that that was how we operated, was to, you know, use all these string machines playing different lines all over the place, and you know, and it did give it, although bit of, you know, a pop record, it had the kind of orchestral depth as well to it. Mm-hmm. And I think that was one of the things that really inspired the guys in Yes, the three guys in Yes who were Yes at the time, which was Steve, Chris and Alan, that they saw the potential of how we, you know, with that coming into their music, they were a turning point in their career, that it could actually open up whole new doors for them, which I think it did in the end. You know, I think it was that the drama album that we did just pushed Yes into the next generation.
Well, my final question is, what is the life playing music and traveling the world and performing taught you about what it means to be a human being?
it's been pretty tough at the moment because, you know, we've been out with journey since the beginning of the year, or since March, I think. Had a bit of a break in the middle. But, you know, going straight off onto Yes at the end of this week into rehearsals, it's going to be, you know, it can get quite tough. But at the same time, you know, I keep reminding myself that, you know, this is a privilege, and being able to play with these fantastic musicians and all this great music, surrounded by all this great music, is really, you know, something that it's not something you can buy. You know, it's it really is a privilege. And then, you know, it gets tiring at times, of course. But you know, I think that anyone, you know, anyone doing a job as such is going to get tired at some point.
Well, life is good, though, it sounds like.
Oh, it's great. Yeah, I know. As I say, you know, although you get physically tired, no way I get tired of doing what I do, because, you know, what better way can you actually spend your life than playing your own music and getting appreciation from a lot of people? It's an amazing experience.